Nothing more than swimming through a few f***ing caves, looking at a few hieroglyphics on a wall. Really? I didn't find any moving artistic narrative. Yeah, you rescue a few fish, oh, great white shark dies. But, you know, that's it. What? Do you know what? I'm gonna be quite controversial here, since my name is controversial, but I'm kind of questioning the credibility of any reviewer who encourages people to spend £15 on a 2-hour swim in a game. I mean, you know, I've reviewed a lot of underwater games that are all better than this. I'm shocked. You probably gathered, I'm in f***ing shock, guys. Because I have looked at this with a total open mind and I have seen nothing. All right, the music's quite nice and relaxed. Yeah, lying on the sofa playing this in front of your mother. Hey, Mam, watch this. Isn't this cool, Mam? Hey, Mam. Mam, you f***ing tart. Watch. You know, but that's about it. That's about it. I can't, you know. If you want to get your girlfriend into gaming, maybe this is a place to start. She'd probably like it. But gaming, bloody hell. If I made a game and says, right, I've made this game, it's called Zamdam. Now, Zamdam means forever beautiful. And it's about this girl who's ugly. And you have a girl, and you walk her through an enchanted forest. And through the forest, there's butterflies and squirrels and all kinds of cute little monkeys. And, you know, you get a friendly monkey who sits on your shoulder. We'll call him Ziggy Ziggy. And you're walking through the forest with lovely... And you've got to try and find out where you're from and who you are. And you walk through this forest, a beautiful forest. Then it rains and there's thunder and lightning. And Zig Zig goes... So you hide him under this branch and you're sitting there. And the music's going... And then the storm clears and the sun comes out and it's like, and then you walk a bit further through the forest and you see all these ruins of a village of where you were belonged from, and you see paintings in the sand, and that just rinses and repeats all the time. $14.99, and every f***er will buy it and go, I cried when the monkey died. There you go. Gaming 2016. What a pile of bantha piss. Summer. Is it worth a buy? Let's read the words of the developer. From the creators of Amnesia, The Dark Descent comes Soma, or Soma, whatever you want to call it. A sci-fi horror game set below the waves of the Atlantic Ocean. Struggle to survive a hostile world that will make you question your very existence. So what is Soma? I'm going to call it Soma. It could be called Soma, but I'm going to call it Soma because that's what I'm calling it, alright? So Soma, well... I'll tell you what it isn't. It isn't what it's advertised to be. You see, this is a very difficult game for me to accurately review because I'm going to read the description again, parts of it. I mean, it says here, from the creators of Amnesia, The Dark Descent. So they want people to know that they're the people that created this. Comes Soma, a sci-fi horror game. So they're classing this as a horror game in a science fiction setting. Now, The Dark Descent was a horror game, but it was in a like an old Victorian days setting kind of thing, you know? So, they've said it's a horror game. They've said it's up by the people who made The Dark Descent. So, essentially, what they're saying is, hey guys, we've made another game. The people who brought you that amazing Amnesia, well, here we are again. And so, people are buying the game on the premise that they're going to get Amnesia again. They're going to get as good an Amnesia because, let's be honest, this is $22.99. It's not a cheap game. It's not a low-budget jump-scare game that Steam's full of. You know, these piles of shit that people don't know what they're doing but think, hey, look, we'll put a scary face on the screen and that's a horror game. You know, Amnesia was never about that. Amnesia was about dread and atmosphere in the same way that Outlast was about dread and atmosphere. But Soma doesn't project that same dread and atmosphere. The way I would have described Soma, if I was being honest and I was doing the write up for this. I mean, I haven't, obviously I think of better words, but I thought something along the lines of, from the creators of Amnesia: The Dark Descent, Soma is a sci-fi game with an adventure story with horror elements. I'd say something along the lines of that, because this game, in my book, is not really a horror game. There's not much really horror in there. One of the things that made Amnesia was the dread atmosphere that I've already mentioned. You didn't see the monster that often. There were sections of the game where you had to get through, as there was in Outlast, where you had to get past some kind of patrolling monster. And if it saw you, and it could see you from a good distance away, it was on you. In Soma, you'd be amazed at how close you can actually go to these things before they come for you. One of the monsters, if you look at it, it comes at you. That one was particularly scary. It's one of the first ones you meet. The others resemble a turd on legs. They're kind of blind as bats, but when they do see you, they can move quite quick. But they became more of a frustrating annoyance than a kind of, oh my goodness, here comes another monster. The first 2 hours of the game scared me because I'm a scaredy cat. The third and fourth hours of the game scared me because I was meeting new monsters. The fourth and fifth and sixth and seventh hours of the game didn't scare me one little bit. I'd become immune to this endless procession of monsters that were patrolling around the place, and I was hide and seek, and I didn't feel a sense of dread. All the noises that come on, there's far too many loud bangs and cracks and creaks that's going on. It's, they've overdone it. The masters of horror have f***ed up and overdone it. It's too much. They've tried too hard to make this game scary, and with Amnesia, you know, they didn't do that. They didn't need to, because the setting itself did that for you. It's like Outlast, you know, Outlast, they didn't try too hard, because they must have thought, this game doesn't need much more. It's already scary as shit. You know, you can overdo it, you can put too many ingredients in and spoil the dish. And I believe that's what's happened with the horror in Soma. They've tried too hard to make it scary, and I think they've f***ed up with the setting. I mean, I'm not saying it's a bad game. It just isn't a bad game. It has a very interesting story. It has a... I'm not going to spoil it for you, but what the story is about is you go for a brain scan in present day times. You come round, you black out, you come to in this sci-fi world set a long time in the future. There's no humans knocking around, it's just machines, and the machines actually think they're human at first. And it's kind of weird, because you don't know what's going on. Then you realise that what's happened is there's been a massive calamity happened with this asteroid that's hit Earth. And people have moved to the Ark, and to get on the Ark, you get a brain scan. You get scanned, and a copy of your brain is uploaded into the Ark, into a machine. Now, the machine then takes over you. You're kind of living in proxy then, you see, because you've got yourself, who you were, the human you, and then there's the machine, which is now you, because all your thoughts from that machine are in that machine, but they're still with you as the human person as well. So, like I say, there's two of you, an identical copy. So what the people were doing was actually killing themselves after they'd been scanned so that they could live on in this Ark. But it isn't actually them living on, they're still in the human. But they're in the machine as well. Can you see how crazy it is? And people in this future don't really value life as we value it now. It was kind of like, yeah, I'm happy to kill myself knowing that I'm actually safe consciously living in this Ark. And you are discovering this, and you discover who you really are, which is, it's all very predictable, unfortunately. I was kind of going through the game calling it all out. You can tell when there's going to be an accident. You can tell when something's just not going to work. You can tell when there's going to be a monster moment. You can tell elements of the story when you kind of think, all right, yeah, so am I human or am I a robot? You know, you can kind of tell where you are. Then other things happen in the game, which I'm not going to spoil, but you end up having to make a lot of moral decisions in this game. And I didn't once feel that I was making moral decisions. I couldn't get into the story because I could see where the story was going. I never really felt attached to the story. It was kind of like watching a film that you don't really like. That's how I felt in the game. And it went along the lines of, there's a puzzle. The puzzle's going to be guarded by a monster 9 times out of 10. So to get the solution to the puzzle, you have got to work out the puzzle and work out a way past the monster. Now, as you can't fight in this game, you have to outsmart them, which generally means play hide and seek with them. For example, there's a part where you have to restart a router, and the router's in the basement, and hey, there's a walking turd in the basement. And so you have to get past this walking turd monster, who makes very loud footsteps, and reboot the router. Now, yeah, it's quite unnerving, but it's more frustrating. There's things where you have to get in a... I'll not be specific, because I don't want to ruin the puzzles, but there's things that if you don't plug them in, they don't work, so you've got to check everything for cables. There is one really fucking annoying puzzle that is just padding, where you have got to set up a simulation using little things like a light source, a setting, a person. You've got to have surroundings and all that. So you're on this computer selecting what you are going to use to run the simulation. You have to have it complete, so you have to cover everything. You've got to have the light, you've got to have the background, you've got to have the setting, you've got to have the person and all the rest of it. But each element you put in uses up memory, and you have to put certain elements in or it won't work. But you run out of memory because the computer can't hold as much memory, so you're kind of like, it's hit and miss what you can put in, and you just kind of sit there pressing for ages until you get them in. There's other stuff where you have to line up a dish and the radio, and there's bits where you have to redirect electricity, and they're kind of like puzzles for noobs. They're very simplistic puzzles, but they felt more like padding than anything else. It was kind of like, you need to hold them up a bit here to spread out the game a bit. I mean, to be honest, right, I've played this for 7.5 hours. I've listened to stories, I've walked miles, I've listened to audio recordings, I've read hundreds of emails and letters and looked at photographs and little post-it notes, read loads of information on storage things, on manifests, oh goodness, you name it. There's so much information to read to get to grips with the story, that if you cut that out and you were just literally running through the story, I could probably get where I am now in 2 hours, maybe even less. It's annoying because I kind of can't get into it, and there's a lot of people getting into this and think it's one of the best things. I've heard it even being called a masterpiece, and I'm like thinking, where's the masterpiece in this? I can't, you know, I just don't get it. I think if this game had been advertised as more of a story-based adventure, then I would be well into it, because I came into this expecting Amnesia The Dark Descent, and I got just a big walking simulator with horror elements and a long, long, deep story. And it, I mean, I'm not going to lie to you, it is fun uncovering the story and finding out how these people died. You see the personalities of the people, and it is fun uncovering all that, and especially the person that you kind of talk to a lot, you kind of start questioning her as well, because you kind of think, hang on a minute, you sound like it sounds like I'm in a freaking experiment here. You know, it's a deep, deep story, and I'm going to end on that, because if I was giving this a score, I'd be throwing around a 7, maybe it's a 6.5 or a 7, probably about a 7 out of 10, but I don't do scores. So what I'm going to do, if you are coming here like I was, because you've read the description and you want a Amnesia Outlast kind of horror game, it's not worth a buy for £22. Grab it when it's 50% off. It's not worth £22 as a horror game. It really, really isn't. So I'm giving it a thumb down. If you are looking for a science fiction adventure game that has a deep story where you get little bits of it and have to kind of dig deep search everywhere, open up the drawers, read every scrap of piece of paper you find, look at every photograph, look into computers, dig deep into the computers, look at logs, look at emails, just really play detective, even though it's on rails and you kind of, you know, you're going to find the stuff anyway. And want a quite a strange story. If you are after that kind of experience with a bit of horror thrown in for good measure, and don't mind some annoying padding and playing hide and seek with monsters that look like walking turds, it's worth buying. Even at £22, it's worth a buy because it is very well put together. It really is. If you're into this kind of setting, the underwater sci-fi in the future setting. So I'm going to leave it there. It's up to you as the consumer to decide what you want from this game, but I think I've set it out quite nicely so you know what to expect. Batman Arkham Knight. Is it worth a buy? Let's read the words. Batman Arkham Knight brings the award-winning Arkham trilogy from Rocksteady Studios to its epic conclusion. Developed exclusively for new-gen platforms, Batman Arkham Knight introduces Rocksteady's unique designed version of the Batmobile. The highly anticipated addition of this legendary vehicle, combined with the acclaimed gameplay of the Arkham series, offers gamers the ultimate and complete Batman experience as they tear through the streets and soar across the skyline of the entirety of Gotham City. In this explosive finale, Batman faces the ultimate threat against the city that he has sworn to protect as Scarecrow returns to unite the super criminals of Gotham and destroy the Batman forever. Yes, guys, we now get to drive the Batmobile, the amazing high-powered Batmobile, through the streets of Gotham City at a staggering 30 frames a f***ing second. That's right, this game is locked. I don't care how many SLI 980s you've got. This game is locked at 30 frames a second. As a lot of you know, and I'm going to mention my rig for those who don't, it's a GTX 770 with an i7 in it, and I've got to run it with everything on low just to hit 30 frames a second. It's the most unoptimized pile of banter wank that I've yet to see on the PC. Actually, sorry, Ark is the most unoptimized pile of banter wank I've ever seen on the PC. This is a close second to that. At least with Ark, it now runs over 30 frames a second, which is more than I can say for this. So there's that out the way for starters. Another shitty, shoddy console port by a company that don't give a flying f*** about PC gaming. But hey, we can only see it 25 frames a second anyway, so what are we worried about? F*** off. So, the gameplay. Well, I'm going to do this review in two parts, because I'll get a lot of death threats. So the first part of this review is if you are an avid PC gamer that likes to play games that require skill, where you feel a sense of achievement whilst playing it and when completing it. So this is the review part one. So as one of those kind of players who's been around for a long time playing games, it's very disappointing to play a game like this where I feel like I've done f*** all. I've played the game for 4 hours and I would play it longer, but I have a feeling I might do myself some physical hurt with a knife if I continue to play this pile of f***ing filth. Because that's what it is to me. It's absolute garbage. It's what is this? What is it? I'll tell you what it is. You've got an open world city. It's the most bland place on the f***ing earth. It's just dark, horrible. Nobody's around because everybody's left. Conveniently, as part of the story, everybody's f***ed off. The only people on the streets are bad guys, so just shoot everybody or run them over. It doesn't matter. Just flying around the streets with the odd ramp here and there so you can go, whoa man, did you see that motherfucker? I put the afterburners on in the bed, whoa man. You know, you've got all that for them lot. And then you've got just side quests and a main mission, and you can either go on a side quest or the main mission. But it's all just a mini game. It doesn't matter what you do. There's no sense of you actually feeling as if you're doing anything. It's like, all right, the Riddler is spotted down at the train station. Ooh, sounds fun. Batman, fly down to the end. You know what the Riddler does? Well, I'm going to spoil it. Who cares? It's not. It's so shit. It doesn't matter whether you spoil it. The Riddler, he says, "Hi, Batman. You've got to do 3 laps of my racetrack. Yeah, so I can see the Batmobile. And I'm going to taunt you as you go around. And it's basically nice padding until you work out the actual layout of the course after you die about 50 times, and then you realize that you can interact with the actual course and bring out ramps and all the rest of it. So you spend 20 minutes going round and round that until you've done it. And so the people who made the game on the whiteboard can say, yeah, 20 minutes time wasted on Riddler mini game, check. That's good. Now we need to add more mini games to get this up to about a 20-hour game. So come on, guys, get thinking. Make more pointless fucking mini games for these fucking idiots to go and do. And so that's the way the game pans out. Then you might go to another one where you have to. We had a big chemical factory we went to, and there was a part where there's a ramp. You have to lower this ramp so you can jump across it with the Batmobile. And so they made that so that it has to be perfectly placed, and if every time you don't get it perfect, you have to grapple back up and then adjust it a bit more, then come back down, try the jump again. Oh, that should take another 10 minutes off. So 10 minutes pointless ramp maneuvering, check. And then you've got groups of people everywhere that you have to kill. There's like, oh, rescue the workers. There's 8 workers or whatever it is scattered around in this factory. And you know what you have to do? You go up and each worker will be surrounded by a group of 6 or 8 fucking retards that my co-host who's doing the combat took out on. So I'm going to introduce you now to the person. This is the first time I've ever done a duel review, but I'm bringing in a special guest who's going to be reviewing the combat for me, and he's going to demonstrate how to rescue a fireman from a group of henchmen. So I'll just cut over to the VT for that. So here we go. Right, Rabbit, press Y and you'll gate crash. That's it. Right, now spam X and kill them all. You don't need to face them, just come on, don't hide, fucking fight them, you daft rabbit. X. That's it. Just keep spamming that. You don't need to face them. The game will do that for you. That's right. Just keep spamming the X. That's it. You're kicking their asses. Yeah. Just him to go. Oh no, there's another one behind you. Oh, yeah, you didn't need to aim. And him. Do him. That's it. That's it. All right, you can stop now. You can stop. Can you break me controller? And now your prize.